Hello, everybody. I am joined today with some friends. This is not my usual intro, but yeah. I'm here with some old friends of ours that you've seen all over the internet. We've hung out together. Things were recorded backstage of us freestyling, bonding, and what may appear to have been a strong friendship, which was completely false. We have not seen each other in a very long time. We see each other maybe once a year, twice a year at best.
Yeah.
And I am...
But I think that's a stronger friendship than seeing someone every day, is to see somebody like...
Because we see each other and it's all love.
Yeah, facts. And it's not awkward.
You mean you're able to just continue on from the last time you saw
each other? Yeah, like even though we don't see each other all the time, that bond is still there. So when we do see each other, it's like cool, like it's not awkward.
Yeah.
Like...
It's not, I don't think it's necessarily a stronger friendship, but that's how, it's a better approach to having friendships, I think. Mm. You get tired of each other
as opposed to, like, you know, feeling like you have to see each other all the time.
Distance makes the heart grow fonder. Fact. And that is true.
That is
with
true.
With even intimate relationships with girlfriends. You know what I mean? That's why I don't date any girl within a 3-mile radius.
Hey, I did a long distance relationship for 7 years. And, you know, we ended up getting married. And now that we live together, God, I hate her. I'm just playing. I'll just play
it. I mean, it's always, if you watch 90 Day Fiancé, they go to their home countries, each other's places, and that's where things start going wrong.
And then this shit falls apart.
That's where it falls apart. Anyways, I'm here joined by Jay Park.
Yay!
Timothy Chantarangsu.
Yes, sir.
Bro, this is like my 8th time on this podcast.
For real?
No, Literally. It's about your 4th or 5th.
Bro.
This is my 3rd. Wow. Well, you got me beat.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think it's like whenever he can't book guests, mm-hmm. he's just like, all right, can you get on the podcast?
Bro.
We can't get somebody else.
This was so lucky that I could pull up, dog.
I am lucky.
Literally, the universe was like, because normally if he texts me last minute, I'm like, ah, dog, I got the babies. You got to give me some time.
Yeah. Right?
But tonight, I happened to be filming with David So in Arcadia at the 626 Night Market.
Yeah.
I was driving back, and he hit me with the text. I was like, you know what, bro? And you're lucky because wifey has fam in town right now.
Yeah.
To help with the babies, and that's why I was even filming tonight. So I was like, yo, I can pull up, bro. Yeah, the universe.
And I appreciate it because you did check in with your wifey before you confirmed.
Yeah, I was like, hold on. Let me make sure she's straight with me being out an extra couple hours, you
That's
know?
That's tight. Yeah. That's tight, man.
No, I think the producers were like, yo, can you get Zico? And then they're like, no, we can't, you know. And then so like, can you just call Jay?
Jay's, you know, you're available, man. I love it. Not
available. I make time.
You make time. That's, all right,
it's different.
Yeah,
I make time.
So he,
not too available.
So he hit Jay Rise. Jay Rise couldn't do it, and then he hit me.
I called 3 YouTubers before you, bro. Yeah, I'm here with the my friends from a long time now, man. We've lived on the webosphere.
Yeah,
that's how long I've just called it the webosphere. That's how long.
I've never heard that word in my life.
That doesn't exist. Okay. I just literally just made it up. Okay. Anyways, yeah, we've all met around the same time, I believe.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Early 2000s.
13 years ago.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys probably known each other longer, but I don't know.
No, facts. Same. Actually, if we're talking about, I probably met Dumb in like when I first started vlogging, which was 2008 maybe-ish. Yeah. And I met you at a ISA show, I do believe.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's a long time
ago. That was a long time ago.
He was like, it was weird because Jay coming in as like a Korean musician, pop star. It was weird. He just kind of came into the YouTube world. We're like, what the hell? You don't belong here. Get out of here. What's up, everybody? This episode is sponsored by the Asian-Canadian food distribution company, Ran Foods. Their Ho Yeah brand products feature a wide variety of delicious instant meals like instant ramen, pho, pad thai, and udon noodle bowls. They also have their own Ho Yeah brand sriracha right here straight out of Vietnam. Look out for Ho Yeah products at your local Costco and grocery chains. They sell quick, so move fast. Check their Instagram at Ran Foods. Foods Inc. for more info.
I think every world that I went to, everybody's like, what the hell? What are you doing here?
Yeah.
Whether it be, you know, hip hop or dance or even Korea.
Yeah, you know, the Crips were like, what are you doing here, bro?
No, even me being from Seattle, like, you know, going over there. But I think when I was in Korea, that's when all the Asian YouTubers started popping off. They started doing covers, comedy, battles, et cetera, et cetera. And then, me being in Korea, I felt like that really resonated with me, just being a Korean American, and I wanted to be a part of that. I wanted to kind of showcase my talents because, you know, everybody else was doing it basically and kind of paving the way. And so like I kind of took that blueprint and started doing the same thing. So
Yeah, I mean, I always appreciated that about you, like still having your roots in like the B-boy scene. And I always think about that, like if I ever won like an Oscar or something and I hopped on stage, like I wouldn't, the first people I wouldn't think is like the agents and managers. Like I'd be thinking like hip-hop.
God. Yeah. God, no.
I didn't even say God. Yeah, God. Like, family, friends, obviously. But I'm surprised they don't think, you know, the early roots, like a theater company they were a part of or something. You know what I'm saying? I mean, don't you think that you should thank them for what?
I practice my speeches all the time in the mirror, yeah?
Yeah.
The first part is always, you know, I always say, you know, They told me I wouldn't make it. You know what I'm saying?
How often are you doing that? You're doing that 2-3 times a day?
Oh, every night, dog. Every night. I got to make sure I'm ready.
But it is interesting, though. Award ceremonies, they don't thank an acting coach. That's or like true. An acting class. I've never heard that. I think they never want to admit that they got help in that department.
I don't think that's it. I think when people, they start somewhere, and then to achieve receiving an award, it takes a long time. You don't receive an award in like 1 or 2 years of work. Yeah, you got to put in a lot of work. So it's like 10, 15 years. So either they might be past thinking, you know, whoever they started with, or it's, you know, people tend to forget like, you know, where they started from when they, you know, once their career starts adding up, then you know, the further it goes back, then it's less kind of prevalent in your mind, I feel.
And they only got 20, 30 seconds up there, bro. Yeah. It's a lot of people. Who are you thanking? For your first award, who are you thanking?
First of all, I'm thanking friends and family, obviously.
But who? Like, is specific friends or family, or just friends and family in a lump?
Yeah, that's mad vague, bro.
I think I'd go specific. Because you can go two angles. You could go two routes. You can go specific or you could go vague.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are things that I would say organizations, like I would be like Project Blowed.
Okay.
The open mic I started at. You know what I mean? Okay. Which was very important to me. It's like that's, pivotal
that
for
that
me.
Does not sound like open mic, but anyways. Project Blowed. The porn company that I started
back
in
the day. Yeah. No, I mean I would thank that. I would also thank hip hop, I think.
Yeah. I mean, but I don't know.
What?
I mean,
you wouldn't think hip hop?
No, it makes sense. It makes sense. I mean, I guess I never really thought about that. But yeah, I mean, I do owe like debatably everything to hip hop and how it's affected my life, right? And
I think
influence
so.
On my life. So
it's all three of us,
yeah. Yeah.
I mean, that's what I always say in Korea. I say, like, whenever I'm on the shows or whatever, they're like, what's hip hop to you? I was like, hip hop literally gave me everything that I have right now, all the opportunities, because I, you know, was a break dancer, because I rapped, because whatever, all the influences that I had growing up here, which is basically all rappers and hip hop. That's why I've had all these opportunities and been able to make a living for myself, give opportunities back, provide for my family, et cetera, et cetera. So, but then I don't know, when you say it in English, it kind of sounds like cheesy. Like, I like to say, I like to thank hip hop. I don't know why, but if for some reason, it's true though.
Well, it's because every music genre name is kind of goofy, you know, jazz. Hip hop, country. You know, it's like every genre name is funny.
If you say it like that, anything is anything
with the jazz
is funny.
Hands. With the jazz hands.
Yeah.
Mass murder. Hey, racist.
No, it is. Know, it's just a very simple, elementary sounding names for each genre.
No, hip hop is kind of, I guess, if you break down the words like hip and then hop. Like, it is kind of like, I guess, almost cute.
I don't want the OGs to come after me. Like, Grandmaster Flash is like, I got something to say. I get it. I mean, I think people tend to acknowledge the most recent people who's made a difference in your life, which is kind of messed up. You know, that the guy who works at the bodega might get a shout out, you know, before an old friend.
Dude just sold me a sandwich. The bigger nigga G.
Yeah, I see him every day.
But I think that's what kind of differentiates people. Like, I feel like people that are more humble, they tend to not forget where they came from and thank the people who really gave them a chance when they had nothing, when people like didn't need to give them a chance. And because that's much more important than, let's say, when you're popping, someone who made you $100 million. That's when you're popping. I mean, obviously that's important too, but when you had nothing to offer and someone lend out their hand, I feel like that's just as valuable as someone, you know, giving you the opportunity to make $100 million when you're popping. Mm. So,
and you know what it is too? I think they're not practicing their speeches enough, bro, because like in my practicing that I do often, I definitely got shout outs to Miss Shigemitsu from high school because of some stuff she said to me back senior year, and like Mr. Carlin, drama teacher, you know what I'm saying? That's what you get. You just got to get more organized, bro.
Organized, yeah, yeah.
With your thank you speeches.
With people who made a difference. Like, yeah, yeah. Put it in my mind and Rolodex.
Yeah.
I have those, but haters.
Ah, yes.
Do you have those?
Of course. I'm not going to name them.
No, you don't got to name them. Yeah, but do you have a list of comments that haters have made in your head and people, like distinct people?
Wait. So,
Do you remember specific haters that has said something to you and it stuck with you? It kind of stung.
No, nothing stung, but
no hater has stung you?
Nah. I mean, I feel like I'm my own harshest critic. Like, if they have anything to say, I already know.
But that's what I'm saying. That's when it really hurts. Nah. When a hater says something that hits close to home.
I think it's when it's more funny that, like, you know, when they like clown, like roast me, and I'm just like, oh, that's pretty clever.
Wow.
I am short. Okay, cool.
Has anyone saying you're not hip hop hurt you?
Ooh, no. I mean, just because it's like I'm pretty comfortable with who I am, and so I don't really let what, you know, people that don't really know me, their opinions of me, like, kind of sway or hinder my mentality.
Because, like, I know when you came back as a solo artist in Korea. And started doing more rap music and stuff. I know there were people saying like, he's not hip hop.
No, 100%. Yeah, 100%.
And how did you take that? Did you like?
I was like, yes, I am.
Did you respond with a windmill?
No, yeah, facts. no, to be honest, I think it's one of those things where it's like, I mean, for me, I know, you know, the life I've lived and where I came from and et cetera, et cetera. But they might not know. You know, I don't expect everybody to know who I am right off the bat, so it's my job to kind of prove myself, just like in hip-hop, like just like in anything, like comedy or, you know, the battle rap field or hip-hop. You have to prove yourself in order for people to acknowledge you and to kind of move up the ranks. And so, you know, to me, it wasn't anything that I felt entitled to, you know, just me being like in the b-boy world. You have to battle and earn your spot. So it's like, for me, I was willing to take on that challenge, even though it was in a language where I wasn't the most fluent in.
Right.
I was just kind of like, yo, okay, cool. Like, you'll see.
Yeah. So,
like, it just takes time.
I know Tim gets kind of offended by that too.
Well, you know what's crazy is I was just thinking, like, after years of, like, you know, mad, like, hater comments or whatever, like, the racist shit doesn't bother me, you know what I'm saying? Call me a chink, little dick shit, dog eating shit. It never bothers me anymore. But if someone's like, cringe, I'm like, what? Excuse me? I'm like, how?
Yeah.
How so? You know what I'm saying? I'll always reply when they're like, cringe. I'm like, what? How was this cringe, dude?
Yeah,
I'm like,
yeah.
I just want to know. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I'm like, explain, please.
Yeah.
Or like that little shit will bother me. I'm like, all right, what are you talking about? You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. No, I agree. The comment that gets me the most angry is meh. MEH? Are you crazy? I'm about to lose my shit.
Yes.
Meh, bro.
How you feel?
Meh is crazy, bro. 100%. I'm sorry. Meh is crazy.
It's like, this episode was meh.
Or, bro, I'm going to take it next level, dog. Some shit they'll always get a reply out of me when someone's like, dot, dot, dot. I'm
oh,
like,
my God.
What you mean? What the fuck you mean, dot, dot, dot? What are you trying to say?
There's so many haters like that on stand-up comedy clips and stuff online. Mm. There's always people saying something, because everyone's a comedian in those comments.
Right.
Well, it's not just funny.
Everybody's something in the comments. Like, even when you're playing sports, like NBA players.
That's true.
Yeah, they're going to criticize NBA players like they've played in the NBA
That's
before.
The biggest extreme, I think, of hater comments right there. Athletes.
Everybody, because everybody's an expert. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, they're allowed to do that. That's the thing.
100%. I feel like, you know, if we need public, I guess,
validation.
Yeah, validation or demand in order for us to make a living, we have to somewhat accept people's opinions, even though they have no credibility or not. It's like, that's what comes with it. It is what it is, you know?
The shit that be killing me is like, when I reply, because usually I reply because I'm like, you know, taking a shit. I take really long shits, yeah. So I just be on the toilet.
How long? Like 20 minutes, 30 minutes?
20, 30 minutes.
Yeah.
But wait, but you're already done and you're just staying there letting the crust dry.
No. I'm not letting the crust. I'm not letting it get crusty because sometimes I feel
it's still
like
going.
If you just wait, you get a second wave. Motherfuckers be trying to get up and get out as soon as that first wave. But if you wait, you get a second wave. That
you would not be sitting on the toilet if iPhones did not exist, for sure.
No, that's not true. I would be reading.
Ooh.
I would be reading the back of the shampoo
bottle.
You
go full analog, huh?
Analog. Anal log. Whoa.
Okay. All right. That worked, actually. Okay. That really worked.
That did work. Oh, shit.
Okay, wow. Yeah,
that was a bar.
Would be you. There would be no instance where that would be used in a battle, but that was like a battle-like line. You know what I mean?
Right, dog. Yeah. I know, man. Let me
slow it down.
Slow it down, bro. Let me get good at actually memorizing. I will kill your ass in a battle.
Analog. You just did a realize, but with analog and anal log.
What were we talking about?
Okay.
What was
the
point I was making?
You're sitting on the toilet. And you respond.
Oh, yeah. When I reply to somebody because I'm literally bored, because I literally internet for a living, right? And motherfuckers like, LOL, you mad? You mad? You replied? I'm like, bruh, it took me 3 seconds to write a reply. No, I'm not mad. I'm having fun with you because this is the fucking internet and this is what people do, facts. You know? But God, that shit rubs me the wrong way extra, and then I just and then I'm mad for real.
Yeah.
But that, I feel like that's what people want. Like they want to get a reaction, because like for them, getting that reaction, it kind of is it's something special for them. Like someone that I watch, or someone that's famous, or someone that has a million followers, I got a rise out of them. They responded back to me.
I know.
I mean, that's sometimes I get a rise out of that. Like, I'll comment under a friend's, you know, Instagram post. And when that gets 4,000 likes, I'm like, ooh, yeah, I did it. I did it, boy.
Yeah, that's what we talking shit.
There was a picture of Anderson. He did that AI like image of him like with like big tits.
Yes.
And I put Milk Sonic. 5,000 likes, baby.
Yeah.
It's still there.
You think you're so
Milk
cool.
Sonic. Oh, my Lord.
Killed it.
No, that was good.
But I got to say, so there's now a new thing that people can criticize because you just dropped the product. And that's a different type of criticism.
That was a very good segue.
That was actually a fire segue.
Yeah, well, I'm just saying, because you dropped a new soju alcohol brand.
Yeah.
And now people can criticize food and beverages and products. Is like, that hurts. You know what I'm saying?
I don't know. So I didn't just drop it, but we dropped it. So we dropped one soju last year, February.
Right.
And, you know, thankfully, it made a big splash in Korea. Right. And then obviously, you know, a lot of people had reviews about, because if you have a lot of hype, then you have all these influencers and bloggers and people reviewing your product, basically reviewing your, and then so there was some good, you know, reviews, and there were also some bad. And so for me, I don't ever feel like, I feel like taste, I feel like music, fashion, whatever it may be, it's like whatever floats your boat, basically. It's so subjective. I don't get, but like, I don't expect everybody to like me. I don't expect everybody to like my soju. That's why I always do shit that just I like, and then it attracts people that are like-minded or that like what I like. And
well, you
like,
dropped when you drop a new soju, you're going against years of conglomerates and a certain type of soju people have been drinking for a long time. You are like the mumble rapper of soju. Like going against a generation of hip hop that's existed.
No, and that's the thing. I think that's also how you look at it. Is like, people might say that I'm going against it, but I just feel like there's space for everybody. Because, you know, because, you know, I feel like there's space for, I think LL Cool J said this, like, yo, like, where's all the OGs at? Like, I'm still doing my shit. Like, yeah, there's people that like what LL Cool J has to say and what he's been through that, let's say, I don't know, like a Sexy Red, is that her name?
Yeah.
A Sexy Red can't, you know, she can't speak on those subjects because she's never been through those types of things before. She's never experienced everything that LL Cool J's experienced. So some people might hold LL Cool J's experience and his raps and his bars a little bit more dear to their heart than what Sexy Red might have to say.
Just and say it, booty hole brown.
Booty hole brown.
Booty
yeah.
hole
say
brown. That, booty yeah. hole brown, you know? Mama might not.
You know,
Mama said knock you out, booty hole brown, you know? You know,
okay.
Both have space to live
to
in the
fair,
world.
To be fair, you know? Both immature lyrics. You know what I'm saying? Mama said knock you out, booty hole brown. Yeah. Pretty equal to me, in my opinion.
But you look, arguably, booty hole brown might be the more mature lyric.
It is.
Because you're like, my booty hole's brown.
That is the most vulnerable I've ever heard any rapper go into. Talking about the color of your booty hole, I think, is intimate. It's like you're letting people into your booty hole?
And you're taking charge of who you are and you're proud of yourself.
Yeah.
Like, I think it's okay for like female rapper to say it rather than a male rapper.
You're not going to say your booty hole brown?
I mean, I would say it to you off camera. You know, like, I'd be like, yo, like,
you're literally
my brown too, like, you okay, like, but I wouldn't be say in a bar.
Mine too.
Yeah. Too. And we all got purple dicks, so it's
Anyway, so the soju, soju.
Okay, let me taste it.
So while you do that, what I mean by the mumble rapper thing,
do you really drink?
Yeah,
because he's been sober for 9 months.
I know he's not me, dog.
Okay. What I mean by that thing, the mumble rapper thing, is more about a generation, because there's a lot of older soju drinkers, right? Aja cheese and stuff.
Yeah.
Have they given you any feedback?
Yes. I mean, so and that's the thing. So the people think that like this is new. No, this is actually old. So this is traditional distilled soju. This is how the soju was 100 years ago, or however many years ago soju was made. When the, you know, people started distilling soju or makgeolli back in the day, and so this is what it tastes like.
So
and then the green bottles came along after they banned rice,
right?
Making alcohol rice, basically, because you know the country was starving. So
you're telling me old Asian dudes are drinking that and be like, that little fucker did it.
Nah,
he took it way back.
By George.
Oh. By George.
No, so there's traditional distilled sojus around. There's Hwayo, there's Andong soju.
Yeah.
There's a lot. There's a lot of brands. But then I feel like just with me, it's the first of its kind. That I don't think there's anyone in Korea that started their own liquor brand. And so,
word? Like that?
Yes. So there has been a lot of people that have their own traditional soju, but I feel like someone of notoriety like me,
full on.
Yeah. I think that's what kind of, I guess, got a lot of exposure to the masses. So more people started, you know, discovering traditional soju.
Well, it's great.
Yeah. Thank you, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah. No, it's smooth. It's clean. It's definitely strong too.
Stronger than soju, but it's premium. So basically, it's like the finest rice from this area called the city called Wonju, from the Gangwon-do area, and then just rice, yeast, water, and alcohol, and that's it. And we just distill it.
That's all you needed, man.
It's good.
That's like, does Thai have like an official liquor?
Dude, you know what? Nah. Like I just kind of was asking this question a few months ago. We definitely just, I mean, Thai people just drink a lot of like just dark, like Johnny Walker, that type of shit. You know what I'm saying?
Well, I'm sure they do, but maybe it's not as popular to the masses anymore. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure they do have like an alcohol that they, you know, drink locally. But I mean, you know, everything that they have, like, what is it? Muay Thai. They have Thai. They have Pad Thai. They have so much.
We got a lot
culture.
Of shit.
Yeah, we got a lot of shit. Yeah.
Dude, Thai people just add Thai to and then
Thai,
Muay Thai, Pad Thai. Well, one soju could maybe be the alcohol of Thailand, bro.
So we launched.
You feel like colonizing then?
I'll make some Thai tequila.
Shut the hell up.
No, the thing is, like, so you've known sake for a long time, right?
Yeah.
So I mean, that's the thing. Everybody knows sake. Everybody knows like vodka, like. Not a lot of people know soju.
It's coming up, though.
No, that's what I'm saying, though. Sure. And I want that global exposure. I want it to go global.
I bet you do, owner of a soju company.
You damn Koreans just want to be run everything, man.
Hey, we were very poor 50 years ago. Let us have, you know, our moment.
I love this whole thing. Because Korean people are like, you know, the culture is becoming very successful right now, right?
Yeah.
Like everything from cinema to music and everything.
Fashion, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but like, coming from, you know, hip hop or a poor upbringing, like, you don't want to talk about like how successful you're doing. You know what I mean? So like, I feel like when people talk about the success of Korea, we have to take it back 50 years. Like, we used to be poor, dog.
No, you talk
like,
about the poor shit.
We used to be poor.
Until you pop off, then you talk about the big shit.
But I think that's the thing. That's the reason why it's so popping right now is because we work so hard to escape that that era of
no 100% you know,
that reality is like that's why we're everybody's so popping right now because everybody works like our parents our grandparents work so hard so that we have the freedom to pursue a rap career or because before everyone's just like focused on eating
you know
what I'm saying like so I mean I think it's just a big part of our story like the history is just
do you think you work harder than your parents?
No, I can't say. I work
like
I,
right, like in their prime peak of working.
Because I can't say because it's like one of those things where it's like those conditions,
right?
Like you know, really the country being at war and like you know the government starting to, I guess, take structure. Like yeah because before there was like there's not a lot of structure, so everything was kind of just wishy-washy. And then you know like there's a lot of people try to take power of the country and like political parties like going against each other and like people you know rallying behind the parties and then you know I didn't even know like my dad's siblings like two of them died before he was even born you know like one was trying to escape the war and then his sister got sick and passed away and then another like his brother got shot at like the protests by the government so like I wouldn't want to you know grow up in during those times.
Nah, for sure.
Yeah.
Man, even when my family had the Thai food restaurant, I remember when I first really started getting a little bit of money off the YouTube get a little brand deal or whatever, and my mom would know how much it was for. She was like, what? A little 5-minute video, you get that much? She's like, you know how many orders of pad thai
that's
I have
crazy.
To make just to get like a fraction of
she's
that.
She's like 427.
You know? Right? And I'm like, hey, mom, shut up. Shut up and get this money. Shake your ass. No, I'm just playing.
yeah, I mean, but it's crazy because even during that time, I guess there were a few people that made tons of money.
Yeah.
You know, just a simpler way than just the like the blue collar jobs they would have, like our parents would have, right? Working 9 to 5. There was a few people that like invested in Apple or something.
Right.
Oh, no. I mean, but obviously in every, you know, I guess, country or race or community, there's like a few outliers, obviously, you know?
Yeah. What do you
think? Oh, are you talking about that about like the Chebors or what are you talking about?
No, I'm just talking.
Like, just like people like in general, like outliers.
Yeah, I always find it interesting when like cats during that time just had like a crazy success stories of that time.
Of that era. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I mean, I think, you know, anybody can get successful. But like, I mean, if you work hard enough and you, you know, work smart enough, I think anyone can get successful. But I feel like what's important is what you do with the success. That's like really what, It really kind of highlights like who you are as a person, basically. It's like when you don't have to do shit and you, let's say like, you know, before you have to treat people a certain way because of your financial status or your social status. But then when everybody's treating you like a god, do you still treat people the same way?
I'm getting real deep, bro.
I mean, I'm just saying.
Do you,
like
dumb?
No, I'm kidding.
Do you?
No, I treat everybody shitty equally.
Ever since back when, he's just been
Nah. I love everybody, man. I do have a hard time, I think, communicating with my, I'm not going to say employees, but people I work with, partners and stuff. Because nowadays, it's hard to set a distinct boundary between boss and employee.
I feel it.
And I know a lot of CEOs that I've had conversation with, they have a hard time talking to their workers because they're scared.
Scared of what?
They step on eggshells with the way they approach.
Because they don't want to get put on blast?
They don't want to get put on blast or canceled. Mm. But it's like, when does that line's gotten so blurred between employee and boss, you know, as opposed to like what's considered
as long as you put
toxic
a little,
way of conversation.
As long as you put a little winky emoji at the end of the dog, you did, bro.
That's your cancel proof
hey,
thing.
If
an
you ever
emoji?
Do that again, you're fired.
Winky face.
That's how Asian CEOs do it. They put the ha ha ha.
No, not gonna lie. Like, no, I get it. Like, even you know, on the small scale of like just doing like little YouTube sketches or productions or whatever. You know, sometimes, bro, it's like it gets frustrating because you know a lot of people are just like dumb, you know what I'm saying? It's really as cliche as it sounds, it's hard to find good like a good team, good, you know what I'm saying? Sense. Like it's really difficult to find people sometimes and it gets frustrating, you know what I'm saying? And like I try to like boss up firmly, but that at the same time, you know, like yeah, facts, I'm trying to be nice, right? But it's kind of like LOL. can you not do that next time? Yeah, but LOL, your color grading is kind of trash.
Yeah, but that doesn't really force them to change it up.
Yeah, yeah,
almost.
Yeah.
You got to sometimes throw a flower vase across the room and break it on a wall.
How Korean of you.
That right there will get them into shape.
I feel like that's very Korean of you.
It's not Korean.
From what my...
No, first of all, we would never break a flower vase. That's an expensive item.
From what David So tells me of his upbringing, and I dated a Korean girl for a year when I was 15. I feel like that's how y'all manage your emotions and shit.
So, what, rage?
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like, you know those rage rooms where you like break stuff? I think Koreans started that. I could be wrong. I think they started the rage rooms, which is crazy.
But it wasn't even a rage, it was just their house.
Yeah.
And they just broke it.
Yeah, I don't know. I think the K-rage thing is changed. Mm. You know, because now we have something to live up to. We see the K-pop imagery and all that, and there's an expectation.
And also, you know, the Korean people, they are very... conscious of what other people think of them.
Oh, okay.
And so I think with the internet now and how vocal people are with their opinions, they try to be a little bit more mindful of how they conduct themselves.
Interesting.
I feel like, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know, even like my mom, like back in the day, would just yell everything. Like even just regular ass conversation would just yell everything. And I think she knew that it was a problem. So like she worked on it like, a long ass time to like
really
yeah
that's crazy.
She worked like back, but not for the internet, but it was just like she just felt like like she, you know, she started going to church and then she just felt like, yo, this is not a way to converse with people.
Yeah,
like, I need to like tone it down. And then so now she's just kind of like very like calm.
Dang.
Because she worked on it for like 25 years, 30 years.
Sheesh.
Are the Thai people generally peaceful people?
I wouldn't say everybody's necessarily peaceful, but they are very like happy people. Like
they
that's
are.
Kind of the yeah. stereotype of like, you know, it's called the Land of Smiles. That's the nickname of the country.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Land of Smiles. And I like that.
And I'll tell people all the time, like when you visit Thailand, you know, I feel like a lot of other countries will be nice to you because they're trying to like, you know, dick you out of some money. But Thai people, like, yeah, they're gonna try and dick you a little bit, but also they're just genuinely they fuck with foreigners out there. They love foreigners out there.
Yeah.
Like everybody is really just welcoming and nice and just like, well, they like to have the time, you know?
I guess the customer service or the hospitality out there is very important because tourism is such a big thing for the economy out there.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
right?
A lot of the country's revenue they get from, so like that, I guess that sense of like hospitality, like making feel someone at home, is just kind of like embedded in the culture now, just because of how big tourism is out there.
I mean, I've visited Korea, and at times, you weren't as hospitable as I've wanted you to be.
Me?
Yeah, you at times. Yeah, there was
just because you called me to the podcast so many f-ing times. I'm just like, bro. All right, enough is enough.
Nah, you've been great. You've been hospitable. You no, pull for sure. up.
You ever been to Thailand?
I just went.
Oh, word?
I just went a few months ago.
And?
Great, man. Great.
Did you enjoy yourself?
I loved it. Yeah. The food was fantastic. People were really amazing, honestly. Mm-hmm. They really are friendly.
And it's genuine.
Yeah.
For the most part.
And people are saying, like, the Thai people, like, Thailand is next to pop off in Asia after, like, Korea. Like, people are saying, like, because everybody in Thailand is, like, hella fly. Like, the music and stuff, the fashion, everything is getting super, like, you know, just polished and just dope, basically. And so people in the like the tastemakers are saying like, yo, Thailand's next up.
You better catch that wave, Tim.
Man.
you're in this territory where you kind of transcend just Thailand, though, you know? It's like Bobby Lee. Like Bobby, you know, he doesn't necessarily not known amongst like mad Koreans out of Korea, but over here, it's not just like Koreans. He transcends all over, you know.
I think they kinda I mean, actually, the last time I was in Thailand, I was out there for like a show, like it was like a big YouTube event, and I actually got to perform, and a lot of them didn't know I was Thai, and I was able to get on stage and start like talking my Thai shit a little bit, you know, and everyone was like, oh, because they had no idea, you know, so that was kind of a dope moment for me.
I think like when you think of like Tim, you, like when you think of us, like you think Korean, but when you think of Tim, it's just kind of like. his personality and his character is like, you don't really think about, like, you know he's Asian,
right?
Yeah. But you don't know what type of Asian.
Mm. Yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
So I think that'd be dope if, like, you started doing stuff in Thailand and started connecting with, like, all the
yeah,
locals.
Yeah,
like,
I always wondered what kind of Asian De La Ghetto was. You know what I mean? I was like, I just couldn't put my finger on it.
Yo, my thought I was Filipino for so long, right?
Facts. That's what I thought at first.
I mean, and a lot of people still do. But I remember when I was, like, first, like, kind of beginning to pop off, it would be dudes at, like, little house parties. They'd be like, yo, Delgado, you Filipino, my guy. My guy, you rapping for us Filipinos.
That does sound close to Delgado.
Delgado,
yeah.
Man, let's go get some adobo, you know what I'm saying? Maraming salamat.
Let's get it.
Putang in the mall, yeah. That was the same thing with Andrew Garcia.
Oh, yeah, by association, for
like,
sure.
And he was like, I'm not going to correct him if you weren't. I wouldn't either. Go
but,
get that
wait,
back.
He's Filipino, right?
No, he's Mexican, dog.
Oh, is he?
Yeah.
Holy.
Yeah.
You just blew my mind.
What were you saying about the sriracha
thing?
Oh,
sriracha. Yeah, my dad, ever since, like, really, you know, like, when sriracha really got, like, popular amongst the youths, he was always telling me that sriracha, the initial recipe, was stolen by a Vietnamese dude it originated in Thailand. There's actually a city in Thailand called Sriracha. It's like, that's the name of the city in Thailand. Yeah. And that's where it originated. And then I guess, you know, it wasn't patented, wasn't copywritten, whatever. Yeah. So someone took the recipe. So my dad would always be like, oh, you know, they stole the Thai's recipe, blah, blah, blah. Wow. And he would be like, you got to use the Thai sriracha because they got separate shit. You know, it's slightly like a little sweeter. But one day I caught his ass using the green cap. He was like, oh, I can't stop eating it.
I like how your dad was just talking about, like, he has steak in it. He's like, they stole it from us.
Trader Joe's sriracha is kind of fire, too, not going to lie.
Oh, damn, bro.
I'm sorry.
But that's not your dad's brand.
No.
Oh, I thought that's what you're building up to.
No, he was just, you know, trying to rep for his people.
No, 100%. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I feel like back in the day, like, everybody just kind of took it from each other, you know?
Like, yeah.
It's like the Wild Wild West.
Well, and also, it's just one of those things where it's kind of like, yo, if that shit is good, like, obviously, I'm going to want it for myself as well, you know? I'm not going to just be like, all right, can I ask you for it every single time when I could do it myself?
And people weren't, like, quick to copyright and, you know, a little Thai farmer in random sriracha Thailand wasn't like, let me get the patent on this.
So actually, I thought about this recently because you just put out content where you interviewed your ex-girlfriend.
Oh, I did. Yeah.
And you've always had a very public publicness to your whole all your relationships.
Yeah. True.
And you, on the contrary, have been very private.
Yeah.
So if you have a relationship, would you not let your friends know either?
You probably not, because you're just a dog. You're a dog.
Just be talking.
You're just a podcast. Dog. No, I'm just playing.
No, but would you?
I don't know. It depends. It depends on, I guess, who it is, and just kind of like where I'm at that time in my life.
If it's a baddie, you'll show her off.
I'd be like, yo, wow. my guy.
Which tells you what kind of relationships he's had.
No.
What he's trying to say is he's not gonna bring his girl around you.
Because you specifically.
Oh, you are I not see.
Everybody else knows except for you. No, I'm just playing.
That's
just
a compliment if you think playing. I would take your girl. That is a huge compliment. You are private in general.
I mean,
I'm just
private about my life in general. Not just that, but just in general. Just kind of like, because I've been in the public eye for so long. There's certain things that I just want to enjoy for myself, whether it be, you know, just my personal life. Like, I self-promote myself, I self-market myself, I founded companies, so I have to do a lot of things and be in front of people and say a lot of things, et cetera, et cetera. So, and obviously that all that is true to myself as well, it's all authentic, but at the same time, I'm not trying to put my whole life out there. I'm trying to move like Jay-Z or Keanu Reeves. Or, you know what I'm saying? Like,
But Jay-Z's real public with his relationship.
Somewhat.
Because he has to be, though. It's not that he's like, yo, yeah, hey guys, I'm dating Beyonce. We just had a kid. People report on it because he's Jay-Z, because it's Beyonce, you know? And because of that, I feel like he's even a little bit more protective, because people are going to just make opinions or assume things or when they don't know shit.
Yeah. You know?
And there's some things that I don't care if they do that about me. Mm-hmm. But I don't want them to do that about my family or people I care about. Right. Or my, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't want them to just, oh, look at that, like, this, and he did that, or she looks like this, or he looks like that, or et cetera, mm-hmm. et cetera. So there's some things where I kind of want to do my best to protect as long as possible. Like Drake, yeah, Adonis. Yeah, yeah. You know what I'm saying? Why do you think that he didn't have
the kid put out on blast? Yeah,
no. He did, though. But why do you think that he didn't say, like, yo, I have a kid?
Yeah. How do you balance that?
I mean, you know what? I try to. Here's the thing about it. Like, Chia is very, she is more of a private person. So everything I put out, like, it's all a very controlled situation. You know what I'm saying? Like, any post with her or any, like, video with her, she approves first. You know what I'm saying? Like, nothing is out of her comfort zone, right? Like, I don't put out anything that she feels is, like, too personal or that she feels like, you know, is a little too invasive into our own shit. Like, there have been things that, like, I cut out because she's like, nah, this is like, this is our thing, this is special for us.
So,
like,
you run it by her, or do you put, have you put out something and you got in trouble too?
I run it by her.
Yeah.
There's probably only ever been one time where like, the only thing she really has me ever cut out is like some shit might look a little too like, yo, it's a little close to our house, you know what I'm saying? We're not trying to like put that out there, right?
Facts.
There's also been times where it's like I might have made a joke to a homegirl that she felt was a little inappropriate, you know what I'm saying? Like there was one time I was like, I was shooting a music video with Danny Riel, and like, just like as a joke, I was like, you know, I was vlogging and I was like, all right, yeah, you know, Danny told me to hop on this track. I said, yeah, if you hop on this dick, just playing.
Right.
She was like, you know what? Get rid of that joke. And I was like, oh, yeah, immediately. Took the video down, cut the joke out, put it back up. You know what I'm saying?
Right. No, I get that. That's out of respect and love.
Yeah, because look, like I said, she's not someone who's trying to do this shit, right? Like, she would love to just, you know, be behind the scenes all the time, right? So it's like the fact that I put her in everything, I want to make sure that she's just comfortable, because she just, that's not her vibe at all.
Yeah, man. I respect that. I feel like things can get really intrusive out in Korea, like the celebrity culture.
Anywhere. I mean, even out here.
Yeah, even out here.
Like people like, you know, TMZ, or like people like, what is it? Paparazzi and all that shit. But even in Korea, like, even with YouTube and with everything, like, people are very comfortable, I feel like, putting a lot of their life out there, and it works for some people, but some people are not. Like, my mom and dad, like, whenever they ask them for an interview, they don't want to do that shit.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because they're not trying to be out there like that, like, because they're not comfortable.
When they ask them for an interview?
Yeah, like let's say for, like, if I'm shooting a documentary, it'd be helpful to have my parents in there.
So you'll ask your parents?
No, I won't.
Oh, you won't, because they don't want to do it.
Yeah, because I already know. And I don't want to make them do it.
Of course.
Because, like, to exploit my my parents for my story, for my benefit. I'm not trying to do that. Like, I'm good where I'm at. Like, I don't need to exploit myself or my family in order for it to benefit me. Like, if they want to do it, obviously, I'm thankful.
Yeah.
But if they don't, then I should respect those boundaries. That's why, like, I don't get too personal in my music either. Whether, you know, obviously, there's going to be shit that I went through, or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But if it's just only I went through, I'll be comfortable talking about it. But, you know, I'm not trying to, like,
you don't get specific.
Specific in your with, like, my family members or who I went through with what.
Yeah, I mentioned just, Cross Streets.
Huh?
Yeah. Oh, I'll be exploiting my kids, bro. Get them IG likes up, boy.
Yeah. I think there's boundaries. I mean, you've done really well, Tim, I gotta say, with kind of navigating that. Yeah, even facts. Though it's like you've really let people into your world.
Yeah.
I don't feel like
much. It feels like it's very you. It doesn't feel like you're selling yourself
in order to.
It just feels like, yo, like, this is me.
Yeah.
I'm comfortable with you guys, like, what, looking at this part, but this part, no.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, you're media trained.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You know how to be out there and
but not be out there.
Yeah, exactly.
But I mean, he's been doing it for a long ass time, though.
You have.
He's probably had hella trial and error.
Yeah.
Was there a lot of trial and error?
I mean, look, there's definitely been videos I have taken down. And, you know, for example, now, bro, like, if I'm, like, vlogging, I'll take the little behind-the-scenes camera out. I let everybody know. I'll be like, yo, vlog warning, about to take the camera out, right? Because it was a long time when I first started doing it where people were, like, just annoyed. You know what I'm saying? Especially, like, my boy, like, Brick was like, God, get the camera in my face. You know what I'm saying? Or people weren't aware that they were on camera and they had issues with it. You know what I'm saying? Or, like... and now it's like And now I just I'm aware of that, so I try to let everybody know what's going on, so you can get your face, fix your whatever. Yeah. You know, it's just, it's all kind of a learning process.
Yeah.
But I feel like a lot of people don't know those boundaries. You know what I'm saying? Mm. You go to, like, back in the day, you go to a YouTube event, everybody got their camera out in your face, not asking you if it was okay. Like, everybody just in your face, and right. There's all these people screaming, yeah. It's like, oh, come on, bro. Like, and you know, the kids will come up to you today with their Snapchats open, like, ew, say what's up to the gram. I'm like, ah, oh, God, hey, what's good? You know, you have to, or else, like, you look like an asshole. But, like, they got no couth, you know.
You guys haven't seen each other, what?
I haven't seen you in, like, hella long. Like years. I mean, obviously, I've seen him, like, in the battles, and I've seen him on Wild N' Out, and, like, the clips that go viral and stuff right. But, like, what have you been up to, bro?
Shit, man, you know, I got a couple kids now.
That's
the latest and greatest. Got a couple kids.
Congratulations.
Thanks, man. Couple random, like, MTV shows aside from Wild N' Out.
Yeah. And then, yeah, I know that you do the podcast as well.
Yeah, podcasting, man. You know, trying to write a movie, David So, trying to capitalize on this Asian wave right now, because we're getting in movies and it's kind of cool, you know.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing, you deserve it too, bro, because you've been in it and we've all been in it before it was a wave. You know what I mean? It was a little ripple.
we was rippling, we made
the ripple.
Yeah, bro.
I always say that. It's like, we were talking about this the other day, where we're like, damn, I wish, like, we were younger during this wave. But to be honest, we were actually really lucky. We were like the 1% of Asians that were, like, actually making a living off of it.
Yeah, facts.
So I don't see it as like, I wish this happened 10 years ago. I'm more like, damn, like, we're still able to enjoy this.
I mean, I honestly kind of look at it like this, bro, like, because some people, you know, especially when everything in just Hollywood started changing, and you would go to auditions, and now it's like, you know, they kind of look at your followers for auditions too. And people will sometimes look and be like, oh, that's kind of like cheating. But I'm like, I feel like I grinded it out for 10 years building an audience, getting these numbers up, so I could just get my foot in the door.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yes. Where I now have a little more leverage, where I was like handicapped before. You know what I'm saying? So now it's like, I got these numbers where I can be like, okay, yes, I'm here in the room auditioning. These numbers help, but also, like, I can do this. You know what I'm saying?
So you just mentioned they look at followers now too in audition rooms, right? Mm-hmm. How many followers you think you have to get by with trash acting?
How many, like K-pop star status?
Okay.
Yeah, K-pop star status. Otherwise, because, you know, I feel like there's, like, let's say Tim's followers, like, he built that from the ground up. So the number of followers he has matches, like, his credibility and his talent that actually kind of backs it up as well.
Right.
A lot of people, they get a lot of followers, let's say, in a short amount of time. And then when it actually comes, like, beyond comfortable settings, because, you know, that's all the stuff that they facilitate. So they might get those numbers from that. But then, let's say, acting or auditioning or places where you're putting yourself out there, where you actually have to have the talent to back it up at that spot. Yeah. You can't edit and do all that shit.
Right.
That's where maybe, you know, they'll lack.
Yeah, I think there was for sure, like, a heavy wave, like, maybe like Vine days, where a lot of people were just getting movies just because of, like, mad followers.
And I think people
saw that. They was kind of like, all right, you know, maybe this doesn't always work, you know?
Like Netflix show, like, movies and shit like
so
that.
So they tried it and it didn't work.
I think maybe, like, the numbers now don't necessarily hold as much weight as it did when, like, people were really trying to navigate, like, what is the internet celebrity? What can we do with this? You know what I'm saying?
Because, you know, internet doesn't always translate to albums or to acting, like, stuff where you actually have to really put in, like, 10,000 hours into your craft.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but people, you know, were like, not just the internet, but mainstream media. And, like, mainstream media is the internet now.
Yeah.
In a sense.
The line is blurred for sure.
The line has got more blurred. And if anything, more people spend time on the internet.
No, 100%. But I think, like, just because you have a lot of followers, there's not going to be 50,000 people going to your show. By, you know, but The Weeknd, or who's not even on the internet, Like he gets 120,000 people to, because he has something that nobody can replicate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You can't just go on an app and replicate what the Weeknd can do or Beyonce can do. So there still is a space for people that have really like spectacular special talent.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you felt the presence in Korea? Like you live in Korea. Have you noticed living there that there has been an influx of foreigners coming in and enjoying the country,
of
tourism?
Course, of course.
You've seen it.
Of course. Just because, you know, I've been there for 18 years now, bro. Yeah. So I lived in the States for 18 years. Now I've lived half my life in Korea. And yeah, it's got a lot different. But I think it's dope just because, you know, when we were younger, people didn't even know what Korean was. Like, they didn't know what Korea was. They're like, oh, are you Chinese or Japanese? I'm like, I'm Korean. Mm. So are you Chinese or Japanese?
Right,
like,
you're going to say that next to a Thai person, bro?
Well, I mean, but, you know, even like...
We're still working on...
Yeah, they're still working on...
But even like, there's a lot of Thai restaurants from even back in the day. Like, Muay Thai has always been popular.
Right.
But, you know, so I think it's dope that like people all over the world are going to Korea to try to find opportunities or enjoy the culture or, you know, enjoy the music, the fashion, the nightlife, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I think it's super dope.
There's a lot of things that Koreans are thriving in. What one thing you think we're not killing it in? And it's, you know, and people think it's tight, but it's not.
That we're not killing it in?
Yeah.
Gosh,
his soju was kind of nice.
Facts, though.
Yo,
facts.
Yo. Facts. He said the soju was kind of...
It's great. Maybe entrepreneurship of like, I think in terms of
practices,
no, in terms of like the celebrities, I think entrepreneurship,
them transitioning into bigger things beyond entertainment,
beyond like, you know, their group or the company that they were at, because, you know, are you going to use it as a step or like not stepping stool, but like as a tool to go to move on to the next chapter of your life? Or are you going to let that define you? And that was your peak. That was your plateau.
That's true. They are very comfortable, I think, in the system of it all. You know?
And I don't think it's that they're comfortable. I think it's a everlasting conflict within themselves. Just because, you know, obviously society like in Korea, it wasn't like accepted to brag about, you know, how much money you make or what. And then like even celebrities, like to use that to build another business to make more money, that's kind of like, it's kind of like frowned upon, basically.
Oh,
it's like,
really?
Yeah, almost. Because like, yo, you're already a celebrity. Like you already get this much love. Like, why, you know, why are you building a liquor brand that is kind of like shitting on this guy that's working so hard and you're using your celebrity to get that exposure?
Right, you're but already thank successful. God,
there's nobody else making a liquor brand. So, yeah, I'm the first one. But that's the thing. So and also I feel like the company is very controlling of what the artist can do when you're in K-pop, just because, you know, there's so many, they're trying to protect their product basically. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I think just that in itself makes it very hard for somebody to get in that mindset like, yo, I'm gonna start this shit, I'm gonna do this shit, like, let's get it, you know?
Yeah. So if like a Korean actor was like striking on the picket line with the writer's strike, that would be outrageous. People like, what are you doing? You're successful. Like the kind of the substance.
No, that's different. That's different. Yeah, yeah. So basically someone of notoriety is bringing exposure to the kind of people that don't have a big voice or a big platform, basically. That's okay. Like that's always welcome. But to try to like, I guess, use your brand to like, to make more money or to kind of like take something away from the little guy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. I feel like that's... So you have to do it in a very authentic...
Yeah, we've seen the dramas.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah, yeah. Yeah. They love the little guy.
But but as do I. You know, I've always had the underdog complex and I still feel like I'm the underdog, and that's why I always try to use my platform to help like other underdogs like me. Mm. And I feel like that's kind of what maybe set me apart, and that's why I'm a little bit more accepted to do what I do, because people know my story. They know that I had to go through hardships. I had to really prove myself in every single facet. And so they're like, all right, cool. Like, you get the pass.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, we've seen a lot of the tropes of, like, Korean dramas, the evil conglomerate, the underdog trying to beat the evil conglomerate.
Or, like, monopolize or buy somebody out or kind of push somebody or blacklist somebody.
In your experience in the business, how accurate is some of that?
I mean, I'm sure back in the day it was super heavily prevalent, but
let me give you one example. So a lot of movies you see like a union striking,
yeah,
and the conglomerate or the corporation hires gangsters to break up the union strikes by beating them up. You've seen this, right?
Yeah, of course.
Is that a thing that happened?
I mean, I don't think they made it up. Like, where, I don't think it's like a you know, an idea, like almost like a Godzilla where they're just like, all right, let's do this. I think, you know, obviously there's a certain reality to that, and that's why they take that, I guess, narrative and bring it into their drama or their movie, because maybe it was something that happened often. I don't know. I can't really say, because I wasn't in business like that, or I'm not involved in politics like that, where I'm like, yeah, that happened to that guy.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm pretty sure that it was prevalent. Yeah.
Hey, you've never worked have you worked like a regular job in Korea before?
In Korea?
Like a coffee shop, you're a barista.
No. So the only two other, so I was like an English tutor.
Word? Like,
were you really?
Well, not like, so I would have like conversational sessions with somebody just to get their, like, I guess, daily speaking up. But I don't really consider that a job. That's more like a privilege. I'm just like, yo, okay, I speak English pretty well.
So you just have to have regular conversations.
Like, how was your
that
day?
Was the lesson?
And just ask questions.
What's good, fam?
Facts. Yeah. What's good, fam? You hear that new Busta? Yeah, for sure.
No, and right. you got paid to do that.
Yeah. So that was more like a privilege. Like,
how about you? You work real jobs before?
Oh yeah, I did. You worked a lot of jobs, right? Like California Pizza Kitchen.
California Pizza Kitchen, Foot Locker.
Yeah, I did. I worked at Pacific Theater.
Hoeing, I was hoeing for a bit. No,
Foot Locker. Like, I feel like I seen you at Foot Locker, like the other day or something. Like, I feel like there's just like a Tim like at every Foot Locker.
Yo, that's the thing with Tim. He has like he has great customer service swag.
Well, thanks.
You know what I mean?
Well, he's like a people person. He's like the people's champ, like a people person.
Is it to hear, like, you hear sometimes be like, you have a star quality, but to be like, you have a great customer service swag. Well, look,
I know how to read between the lines, and I understand the compliment, and I appreciate it.
You're friendly. Like, you sound like you probably got a lot of tips.
I did. I mean, more so, you know, I wasn't the greatest server, because, you know what I'm saying, you know, ADHD and shit. Like, now that I've learned that I have ADHD, it makes so much sense, where I'm like, I was definitely that server that, like, you asked for the ranch, and then I'm walking around like cleaning up plates and shit. I'm like, oh shit, the ranch. And I come back, right. Like, I keep forgetting the ranch. You feel me? And I'm like, I definitely fucked up a lot. But when I was on my shit, yeah, the tips were good, you know?
I feel like, he's one of the guys who are playful when they fuck up. I forgot the ranch.
Yeah.
Where's my Anthony? Like, one of them dudes, you know what I mean?
I definitely, yeah.
You can't even be mad at that guy.
I came with the corny server jokes. Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Girl, you gonna eat all that by yourself?
Like, oh, I see you didn't like it. Huh. Empty plate every time.
Yeah, I worked at Pacific Theaters. Movie theater was one of my favorite jobs.
Dang.
I worked at an insurance company. I worked at like Luis's Italian. Do you know Luis's?
Nah.
Yeah, I worked at Jamba Juice.
Oh, word. Oh, you had a lot.
Yeah, I had a lot of regular.
Oh, so you know the secret flavors.
Yeah. You know the secret flavor? I don't even remember that. That was like 6 months of Jamba Juice. I don't remember.
I thought you were about to say that was like 6 months ago.
I don't remember anything 25 and under. You know, just like, it was all a blur.
I feel it.
Yeah, but I mean, you talk about a lot of your jobs in your past content. CPK seems to come up a lot.
CPK comes up a lot just because I still F with CPK pretty heavily. California Pizza Kitchen.
Okay.
Yeah. I still enjoy eating there pretty often, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So like, every once in a while, it's like the go-to. People be like, you still eat at CPK even though they fired you? I'm like...
Did you work there a long time or something or what? A
few years, yeah. No, people talk about it because I got fired for like a really stupid reason. You know what I'm saying? You don't know the story?
Eating leftovers.
Well, I mean, okay, so here's what happened. Like, I can eat a long story short, basically, okay, this is before Twitter was really like the entity that it is now, okay? Yeah. They were switching the uniforms from white button-ups to black button-ups. I didn't feel like wearing black button-ups. So I tweeted at their Twitter, black button-ups are the lamest ever, thinking nobody would see it, right? Someone fucking DM'd me from California Pizza Kitchen and was like, oh, thank you for your opinion on our new uniforms. What store do you work at? I was like, oh, shit. Deleted my tweet, right? But it was too late.
Wait, so were you... Is that when you were popping off YouTube still? Or?
No, I was barely, like, I had some YouTube
going on, then that's right? Why.
But you added them. You added.
I added them. Okay, so here's what happened, right?
Why did you do that?
Because I'm dumb. Because Twitter was like nothing back then, right? So then they went to my, on my Twitter, there was a link to my YouTube, and on my YouTube it said I was from Long Beach. So they contacted the Long Beach CPK general manager and was like, who is this kid? And the general manager was like, oh, that's Tim. And, and they was like, well, you got to fire him. Damn. Because of that tweet and for a tweet where I said, time to go to work at California Skeetza Kitchen. They didn't like that. So,
Man, they did some investigation work.
Yeah, bro.
They went fucking Sherlock Holmes on you.
It was an intern. I must have pissed off or something, bro. Or someone that changed the uniforms was like mad at me. So.
I mean, I could see that being fireable. It was like, let's be honest.
It was like the CEO's wife that like that like put that like into implemented that plan.
Guess what? Black button ups. Oh, it's gonna be great.
And then she saw the tweet and started crying one day. What's wrong, honey? And
okay, like, I mean, to be fair, to play but that those advocate, if we had that, if we started California Pizza Kitchen and those were the things we implemented and we saw that, I'd fire him.
Well, there was a thing.
I'd fire the guy. You're out of here, buddy.
I would have tweeted him back, be like, so?
Yeah.
Wear it, bitch.
And yeah, just be like, there was a thing in the handbook that says you can't badmouth the company on social media shit.
Well, that's pretty
obvious. Yeah, we can't have your one soldier dudes be like, it's all right.
Yeah, facts. Yeah, they probably do that in like the group chat, but you know, not publicly.
Check this out though, if we're talking about the universe coming through, the week I got fired, that same week I won like a YouTube contest and I won like 15 racks and it was like my first big thing, and that was the first time I was able to be like, oh, I got a little bit of money, now I can go hard on this content and not worry about like a quote unquote real job, you know what I'm saying? Nice. And then I haven't worked a real job since, you
and
know?
that California Pizza Kitchen has closed down since.
No, they're popping. No, like,
you've been in the content creation game for so long. When did you see the word content creator actually pop up? Because shit, that wasn't what it was called back then.
Yeah, I couldn't even tell you, bro. Like, it's just one of those things. Influencer wasn't a word back then.
That's true.
You know?
I think it was YouTuber, no?
Yeah, we were just YouTubers.
But I feel like that since now it's like a real job, like YouTuber, it makes it feel like a little bit like not real. So I think like, YouTube obviously is content, so people like they package it like a little bit more prettier. So it's like, yo, yeah, I create content. I'm a content creator instead of like, yo, I'm a YouTuber.
It definitely sounds better than YouTuber. Yeah. Even but if I'm writing it down somewhere, I put a video production.
It is though.
Yeah, it's 100%. Crazy to have like a company that's like a tech company like TikTok or YouTube and have jobs like named around it, TikTok or YouTuber. Like if I was a professional Tinder, I'd be like Tinder. You know what I mean? Like I'd be a professional dating app guy.
Yeah, I mean, you probably.
I'm not.
Pay me $20 and I'll date you on Tinder.
Wow.
I'll swipe left for you.
I had a quick stint on a dating app. Have you ever seen a dating app, Jay?
I mean, I've heard of it. I've never been on it.
You've never been on a dating app?
Never.
You've never been on a
dating app? I mean, I'm sure there's pictures of me on the dating app, but I'm sure that's all catfish.
Yeah, I use your picture. I'm getting no bitches. No, I'm kidding. No. But so you've never been in a dating app?
Nah.
You know how you can assume how it works, right?
Well, I mean, obviously Tinder's so famous, like swipe left, swipe right. Like I've seen content around.
What do you think
it,
of swipe left?
Would I think of swipe left?
Is it yes or no?
Left is a
left is no.
Correct.
Okay.
Stupid trivia. Oh yeah.
Do I get a prize?
No, you don't get any prize. Oh, no.
I've never been on one either because I've been with Chia for so long. But I always thought it would be fun if I was single during the app. Age, you feel me? Like I just thought, like, oh man, it's probably such a good time.
Well, I feel like Instagram is that.
Yeah, true.
You know what I mean? And you get a better like board of their like aesthetic and what they're into, all that, just from their feed.
You ever get on Raya?
Yeah.
Is that shit lit or what?
Yeah. I'm on Raya.
I mean,
now.
You guys.
I'm not like active on it, but I'm on there.
Is that a dating app?
It's a dating app, but like for influencers and
celebrities and shit.
We not really. It's Zanga? Pretty open for everybody.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's open for everybody.
What? Were you ever on Zanga?
I had a Zanga page. Yeah.
Yeah, Zanga?
Yeah.
I never had a Zanga.
For real?
Never.
Damn.
Hey, why?
What were you doing back?
Sorry, I wasn't as vulnerable as you.
Asian shit, dog.
It was like a diary, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
It's like Twitter.
Yeah.
Like the original Twitter.
But you write longer form?
No. Like two sentences.
Yeah. Now, I remember it because I had a crush on a girl. And I found out she had a Zanga, but she didn't know that I knew about her Zanga. So I got all the inside info on her.
She's like, Jonathan Park is an asshole.
Not like that, but just things she was into, how she felt.
Okay.
it was kind of like a cheat sheet.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah.
So
you're
like, yeah, how was that bobo yesterday?
Yes. It's like, I love horseback riding. What are your thoughts on it?
Quick story. I had a homie that he was on this girl's MySpace. He had a super crush on this girl. He's on this girl's MySpace, and she had Somewhere Over the Rainbow, the ukulele version, yeah, on her shit. So this fool, like, he bought a ukulele, learned how to play Somewhere Over the Rainbow, and then eventually, like, was kicking it with her. And she was like, oh, you have a ukulele, you play that? He was like, I mean, yeah, I dabble. Yeah. Picked it up, started playing Somewhere Over the Rainbow. She was like, oh my God, I love this song.
He's like, dun, 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 dun. That's crazy.
MySpace was lit. You'd have to learn HTML coding on that thing.
IMG, SRC, dog. That's how you posted a picture.
Oh yeah, I even forgot about that, bro. I remember DOS mode.
I don't know what that is.
Okay, that's a really old thing. Yeah, this is the whole section where, like, Asian TikTokers are like, you damn boomers.
Facts.
Yeah, yeah. We've gotten in some boomer territory.
No, 100%. I think, like, half of your followers just, like,
it's nostalgic.
X'd out the window right now.
Nah, it's nostalgic. It's nostalgic.
Let me ask you a question. So, you've been sober for 9 months, right?
Yeah.
So, let's say you were to drink again. What would be the first drink that you have? No, and I'm not trying to, like,
That's a great question.
I'm not trying to coerce you to say one soju. I'm just really curious. Like, would it
totally
be?
Totally sounded like that. Yeah, but, okay.
But would it be wine? Would it be beer? Would it be soju? Would it be tequila? Would it be, you know, what would it be?
It would be a vodka soda.
Vodka soda.
Really?
Okay.
Yeah.
You a vodka boy like that?
I was a vodka soda guy. Before I went sober, I would run through like 12 of those.
You're such a girl. Damn.
Nah, it's like, it's healthy.
it's a little bit more healthier.
It's on the healthy side. It's not healthy, obviously. It's still alcohol, but. There was a weird phase in K-Town where everyone was drinking Jameson.
Yeah.
Like, Jameson was like the new soju for a while.
Really?
Like, for like Asian Americans.
Even in Seattle, everyone's like, oh, let's get shots of J-Mo.
Jamie Ginger.
Yeah. I'm not going to lie. I was off the Jameson today because a dude at one of the food tents that we went to was like, had a whole bottle and was just pouring Jameson for us. Yeah.
I guess there are seasons and trends for alcohol too, huh? Like tequila is in right now.
Yeah, but I started that though.
You didn't start that.
Yeah, I started it, bro.
That's appropriation. First of all,
But the bougie tequila wave, I low key started that. Not gonna lie.
We'll explain this.
So my boy Benji, the elusive Benji.
Yeah.
One day he came from a fucking studio session with Stereotypes, and they put him on to the Classy Azul with the bell on top, right? And then he put me on. So, like, 4 years ago, when I started doing No Chaser, we always had a bottle of Classe Azul on the table, and we was always gassing it up. And then all of a sudden, bro, that shit was, like, gone from all the, like, everybody started drinking that shit, dog.
But you were putting it in content and, like, talking about it, vlogging, and all
like,
that.
A lot. Yeah. I was bringing it to people's house parties, and they was like, what the fuck is this? Now it's, like, the go-to bottles at the club and shit.
This is going to be controversial right there on the pod. I already know people are going to say something about that, but you're confident.
Low key.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Bro, George Clooney's about to DM you and be like, yo, I, you know, think otherwise.
So it'd probably be a vodka soda.
Vodka soda,
yeah.
Okay.
I mean, something just nice, still get me a buzz after a while. But speaking of George Clooney, you know, like, he sold Casamigos, right?
Yeah, for like $1 billion.
Like $1 billion. And I know he had like dinner or something with like 10 of his homies and gave each of them a bag filled with $1 million. Yeah, you've heard this story. Yes. We've all heard this story.
And this is true.
Yeah. Is that something you can see yourself doing?
If I made $1 billion?
Yeah.
Oh, easy.
500 mil.
500 mil? Probably.
You still do it?
Yeah, but I don't know. It depends on who, though.
The tough thing is seeing which 10 makes it into the cut.
Yeah, true.
And that's the thing. It's one of those things where, like, me, like, I try to include everybody, like, you know, into my businesses or, you know, whatever. Like, I try to do my part to have people make a great experience or to help people out with their businesses and their endeavors or include them in mine. I don't know. If I had 500 mil or a billion, I don't know what I'd do. But I'd probably do a lot of good with it because I do good with a lot less. So
what's the dumbest thing you spent money on?
Money on? Just probably being on this podcast. I bought this jacket. I'm just playing. Dumbest thing?
Like, do you buy jewelry? Like, you're wearing jewelry right now. You buy those, right?
Yeah.
Like, they don't give it to you.
Probably maybe jewelry. jewelry would probably be, but I think it's like, you know, being rappers and just kind of like when you don't have it, like, and you want recognition and acknowledgement, and like, what is it? How do people give you validation? It's like when they see you, what brand you're wearing, how flashy you are, especially when you're coming up. So I think I spent a lot of money on jewelry to try to be more flashy, to try to get people to notice me. And then now that they do notice me, I'm a little bit more kind of like, yo, okay, that's kind of enough. Like, I don't want to be like...
It's too much.
Mm-hmm. Well, I just don't want to be like seen that much anymore, mm-hmm. as much as I used to be. Because, you know, I got the validation. I put in the work. I did prove myself. And I, you know, I'm not really... I'm comfortable with my career and kind of like where I'm at. Like, I'm not trying to aspire to be more.
No, I get that. I think all of us could relate to that. We've gotten approached and people want photos and picture, you know, they're stopping you at on the street or dinners and stuff like that. But... And then you kind of take a seat back, right? Is there a point that you kind of want back in, though?
Nah.
Once things get, like, too quiet?
Nah.
Have you felt that, like, ever in any of that?
Nah, I mean, I wouldn't... Not on that level where it's, like, you feel like you need to, I don't know, up the clout a little bit more because you feel like it's a little slow. I mean...
Get your team together. Let's up the clout, guys.
Let's get the clout back up.
Yeah. So what are we doing take? Dick pic? Are we starting a fight? We got to diss somebody? What are we doing?
There's probably full... meetings that people do.
That's crazy.
Yeah, that
which is
kind of
wild.
Yeah, man.
Very wild. Some of the stuff that people, because you know, clout and attention is a drug as well.
Mm-hmm.
100%. And so it's like, for me, it's like I want to get attention for stuff I want to be known for, not just for the sake of getting attention. You know, that's I feel like that's kind of selling yourself short, like devaluing yourself, like selling your soul. It's like you're just doing it just to get somebody's attention when it's not really you. It's like I don't think that's how people should move.
Yeah, man. I feel like we've been doing this for so long, like all of us, it's kind of like clout is like, I don't know, it's like for what, you know what I'm saying? Like we got consistency over clout, you feel me? And it's like we've kind of been there where we've been in these spaces where we, you know, we've done some numbers here and there, and it's like, okay, there's no need to force some shit, you know?
I think it's like for us, it's like career over clout and then legacy over career.
What's the longest you guys have taken break from putting something out?
That's the thing for me, it's like I haven't taken a break.
You haven't at all. Like, I feel like you haven't either, Tim. Like, there hasn't been, which is crazy.
Yeah.
Like, even for me, like, I've not maybe not put out albums or something in between, but I've
always been
put
doing
something out. Yeah. So, which is kind of crazy to think. We haven't had...
Like a real break?
Like 3 to 6 months.
No.
Or just of nothing.
But think about
just
it disappearing. Like this. But so, when we were coming up, like 13, 14, 15 years ago, so how many people are still doing their thing?
Exactly.
Yeah. And so that's probably one of the biggest reasons why is because we kept it consistent, you know?
It's true.
Hard work. There
are times I kind of do want to try to disappear for a year. And I would say that is a little bit of my fear of just being in there. Like, I don't want people to forget me at times. I still have that. I fear a little bit.
No, I feel that.
And I'm not saying they will, but like for me, I'm like,
it's like Dumbfoundeed, right? Or was it just...
Dumbfoundeed?
Dumbfoundeed.
That's so stupid.
Dumbfoundeed, yeah. Was it Jeffrey? Jeffrey Park?
Yeah, that's another thing people done to me. I'm a huge fan, Dumbfounder. I'm like, you are not a huge fan, fam. Yeah.
Yeah, no, but I feel that.
I don't know. I have felt that. That's being honest. Like, I do feel like... And I don't think I should feel that way, because if you really feel like you've imprinted your legacy properly, I don't think you should feel that.
100%.
Yeah, and I think as creative people, we just kind of always feel like, okay, it's like, let's on to the next one. You know what I'm saying? Like, what is next? Yeah, you know, what is next in my career? So you can actually feel like you're working towards something. It's easy to like dwell in the past shit, right? Or get comfortable. And that's the thing about it too, is like once we get comfortable, you know what I'm saying, that's when the shit starts to slow down. And I always kind of got to remind myself, I'm like, yo bro, like try to get in that mindset of when you were broke and hungry, you know, so you actually get back to work again, because it's easy once you got a little bit of money to like just chill, you know.
Yeah I mean, I'm be honest, like since you've had kids, does it seem less important, like the other things that you've been pursuing?
Since I've had kids, I actually finally got a new motivation and kind of jump start to get back on my shit.
Oh, okay.
Because I feel like when I talk about being comfortable, it was before the kids where I felt like, okay, I got a little money, I got my house now, I'm chilling, like why go as hard, right? And then I had the baby and I was like, oh, now I need to get back on my shit, because first of all, private preschools are expensive as hell, you know what I'm saying? And it's like, I'm like, okay, now I have a reason to really grind again where I didn't have that.
And all those things are still important to you. Because some people will take it as like, those things aren't as important to me as it was before. And they're, you know what I mean? And yeah, they almost take a seat back from it.
Well, I think what he's saying is like, before it was important for a different reason as right now. Because now, before maybe it's like, to get the clout or the numbers or to make money, it's now it's like to provide for, because this is his way of living.
But it definitely is still for my own ego too. Like I want to like do this movie for myself. I'm still rapping and
shit. But I think those are important. I think it is important that you don't lose sight that those things are still important to you, whether these new important things kind of come into your life.
Yeah.
And I think that's what people kind of, it changes a lot.
And
it's fine. It could, you know,
yeah,
that's fine.
I think it's just, you know, everybody kind of takes it differently, you know?
I told Chia, I'm like, look, we're not having no third one until I finish writing this movie. And she's like, God, you've been bullshitting on this movie for years. We're never going to have another kid. I'm like, all right, just relax, all right?
Yeah.
I just, give me a second. Let me just bang this out and then we can bang it out, you know?
Yay. So.
Yeah, I wanted to have a baby just to get motivated again. You ever consider that? You're just like, oh, damn, if I just had a baby.
You might have a couple walking around, bro.
I know for a fact I would grind harder if I had triplets, bro. Are you crazy? My rap career would be taking off.
Man, it'll get those IG likes up, dog.
Yeah, have you seen likes up since your baby?
Yeah, bro. Engagement is crazy.
Two babies. You said it's doubled up or what?
More so for the girl than the boy. People don't really care so much about boy pictures.
That's interesting.
The daughter pictures go crazy, though.
Oh, man. That's crazy. Do you want kids?
Someday.
You do?
Someday.
Someday, bro. Yeah. What do you mean?
Someday. I mean, I don't want kids right now.
We're already at someday age.
The boy is great. Look at him. This man looks beautiful still. What are you talking about?
Great skin, man.
Nah, I mean, you know, someday. I think I don't ever try to, you know, force something that's very going to, you know, change my life in order because of my age. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, I'm 36, so I should get married now and I should have kids. And I was like, I feel like,
Yeah,
I'm gonna get married when the time is right, when I find the right person, and I'm gonna have kids when the time is right and when God allows. So
for sure,
that was a weird cough. Sorry.
No, it's fine. I mean, you know, you've been ruining the conversation this whole time. So.
Wow.
Go. No, yeah, but anything that God allows to happen is gonna happen. So for me, I just kind of like go with the flow in life. I never try to force anything.
Word. Nice. All right, guys, I think we're going to wrap things up.
For sure.
Speaking of wrapping it up, because you don't want to have kids.
Yeah.
Right, you got it. Analog. Ooh.
That was crazy, bro. I'm
telling you, I would kill this for one.
Yay.
That's good. Yeah, okay, let me ask you. Do you ever think about when you see me battle, like,
I jot down and...
He's like, dumb, you should have said it like this.
I'll be in the shower sometimes. But I just to memorize a whole like fucking like these 10-minute rounds just for one day, like I couldn't do it, dog. You know, I have trouble with that.
Even you can
like
totally do it.
Even memorizing my own shit, I'd be like for tracks I perform, I still forget shit to the day. So it's like
you can totally do it.
I think you have to have the ultimate focus to do that shit.
Jay Park, Tim Chantarangsu.
Yay.
I love you guys, man.
Love you too.
Hope we stay friends for another 10 years.
Yay.
Tune in next week for another episode. What was that sound? Right?
That was me. That was him. He said,
meh.
He said, meh.
Oh, I thought he said, nah. All right. Tune in next week for another episode of Fun with Dumb. Thanks, guys. Peace.
Bye.
Peace and love.